Thank you very much, Mr. Bernard. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Good afternoon. Good. We're awake and ready, right? Ladies, gentlemen, thank you for joining us for the 9th scientific session. This is going to be a very, very interesting session, the last one for today. So we ask you to please give us your undivided attention. We have three interesting presentations and two lovely, well-experienced and passionate ladies to deliver these presentations. The first presentation will be delivered by Dr. Althea East Ennis. She's a lecturer in the Faculty of Medical Science in the University of the West Indies. She completed her bachelor's in medicine and surgery from the University of the West Indies, Mona, a diploma in dermatology from the University of London. Also, she's a fellow of the Royal College of Physicians and a fellow of the American Association of Dermatology. She'll be presenting two papers this afternoon. The first paper, entitled Skin Manifestations of DM, will be presented now. Can we please give her a very warm welcome?
Thank you. Just to clarify, I'm Dr. East Ennis, but this talk was prepared by Dr. Marilyn Swede from Trinidad and Tobago, who unfortunately couldn't be here because of a death in the family. So it was completely prepared by her. So we've gone through quite a few of the skin manifestations of diabetes mellitus, but now we are going to try and cover as many as possible in a short period of time. Now, these diseases can be classified into disorders actually associated with diabetes mellitus. They can be classified as just infections, complications of diabetes, usually due to microangiopathy, macroangiopathy, or neuropathy. Or they can be reactions to anti-diabetic drugs. So the prevalence of skin disorders, we have various studies from Iran, Italy, Turkey, and India. And basically, the prevalence seems to vary from 54% to up to 79.2%. And in one study from Iran, it was suggested that 72% are actually infections. So the proposed mechanism is thought to be poor glycemic control, which inhibits the keratinocyte migration and proliferation, and also leads to endothelial cell apoptosis. There's also immunosuppression because there's impaired leukocyte function, impaired phagocytosis, and chemotaxis. And then the neuropathy, which was spoken about before, you can have sensory, motor, and autonomic. And of course, there's glycation. Advanced glycation end products are produced, which induce reactive oxygen species, induce pro-inflammatory cytokines, and alter the collagen properties. So we're gonna start with one which everybody has been putting. Everybody knows acanthosis nigricans by now, right? So this is common. You see it in 74% of obese patients. It's a mark of diabetes mellitus. It's associated with insulin resistance. It's also associated with other endocrine disorders. And in Trinidad, Bahadur Singh et al. Did studies which showed that it occurs in 52.7% of type 2 diabetics. The highest prevalence was in Indians versus Africans, and it's twice as common in those who have a high BMI. And it is thought to be due to insulin growth factors stimulating the keratinocytes. So here we see it, a lot of people who have these lesions, think they're getting melasma, but they're actually getting acanthosis nigricans on the face. And also you can get it over the knuckles of the hands and feet, very common areas. You can also get skin tags. These are commonly seen around the neck, usually in the same places as acanthosis nigricans, in the axilla as well, and elsewhere. A study done by Akpınar et al. In Turkey compared patients with at least one skin tag versus those who had no skin tags. He found that there were more males than females. There was a significant association with hypertension, diabetes, metabolic syndrome compared to the controls in the study. The number of acrocordons also increased with 2-hour glucose. Acrocordons, by the way, is the other name for skin tags. It's more likely to have, they were more likely to have high BMIs, high total cholesterol, high LDL-C, low HDL-C, and high triglycerides. And again, it is thought that hyperinsulinemia stimulates IGF-1 receptors, and so it increases tissue proliferation. Another thing we commonly see is diabetic dermopathy. These are scar-like. They tend to occur on the legs and on the shins. They are hyperpigmented and atrophic, and they are associated with microangiopathic complications such as retinopathy. Eruptive xanthoma, we also see in diabetics, especially if they have dyslipidemias. Necrobiosis lipoidica, diabetic corum, which we call LDL for short, up to 1.4% occur within diabetics. Two-thirds of people with NLD are diabetic at the time of diagnosis, and it's more common in females. Diabetic bullae, these are blisters which occur on the hands and feet usually, occur in 0.5% of type 1 diabetics, usually in long-standing diabetics. The onset is sudden, there's usually minimal or no trauma. Clear fluid is usually found in these lesions, and they usually resolve by themselves in a few weeks. They're non-scarring, and they're also seen in patients with peripheral neuropathy and retinopathy. Skin thickening, this occurs in 8 to 36% of insulin-dependent diabetics. There's increased fibroblast activity, increased collagen, increased skin thickness, and decreased joint mobility. And if you look here, you can see this finger pebbling, These are called Huntley's papules. They occur more prominently over the knuckles. Now, this thickening of the skin will decrease the movement in the joints, and this we call a chiroarthropathy. And to test it, we use the prior sign. On your right, we have a gentleman who initially was not able to approximate the hands in the prior sign, and after a few months of very good glycemic control, 4 months, he's able to approximate a bit better. Granuloma annulari, these are annular lesions, ring-shaped lesions, looking like ringworm, but not with that scaliness at the edge. You can also have it without the ring shape, if you look at the image on the right. Now, the association is controversial. It's believed to be more common in persons who have generalized granuloma annulari. In a study done, a retrospective study, 12% of the GA patients were diabetic. But in another study, a case-control study with 126 GA patients, they found no association at all. So, jury is still out on that. We also see inflammatory conditions throughout this conference. We'll be talking about the link with inflammation in diabetes and the skin. And these are inflammatory disorders, autoimmune disorders, some of them, which are associated with diabetes. So we have vitiligo, which is an autoimmune disorder affecting the melanocytes or pigment cells. It's more likely to be associated with diabetes. We did psoriasis a lot yesterday, and lichen planus also has been associated with diabetes. Here we have scleroderma, and don't mix it up with scleroderma. It's actually scleroderma. The full name is scleroderma of Buschke, but we've gotten rid of the of Buschke because it's too hard to remember. It affects the upper back and the nape. It's a You get thickened hard skin with a poudre-orange appearance. The etiology is unknown, but we know that there's increased collagen cross-linking, increased amounts of collagen. It's more common in type 2 diabetics, and it's more common in males, even though we have a female here, and it's unresponsive to treatment. And by the way, we don't tell our patients it's unresponsive. It's very distressing for them, so we do help. We do things to try and make it softer for them. We do tell them that it's difficult to treat. You can get acquired perforating dermatosis. These are itchy, umbilicated papules. They become hyperpigmented. They're mainly on the extensor limbs, and they're often associated with chronic renal disease. Now we move on to infections. The prevalence of infections in diabetics is as high as 68%. It's associated with poor glycemic control, especially non-insulin dependent diabetics. And you can have bacterial, fungal, or viral infections. And the bacterial infections are the whole range. So you can have impetigo, which normally occurs in children and rarely in adults. So if you see impetigo in an adult, you really should check them for diabetes. Folliculitis around the hair follicles, ecthyma, which is a deeper infection, carbuncles, which are really deep infections of the hair follicles, cellulitis, erysipelas, external otitis, and this is, in many cases, due to Pseudomonas aeruginosa, and necrotizing fasciitis, which thankfully is rare, but occurs more commonly in patients who are diabetic. Bacterial infections are mainly foot infections. I mean, our feet are closer to the ground, so it's logical. In Trinidad and Tobago, Islam et al. Did a study where he showed that 93.3% of foot infections are associated with type 2 diabetes, 75% had hemoglobin A1C greater than 7.1%. And 70% had previous hospitalizations. And the organisms that were involved are the usual suspects, Staphylococcus aureus, beta hemolytic, Streptococcus, E. coli, Pseudomonas, and Klebsiella. Onto erythrasma, which is actually a bacterial infection that behaves like a fungal infection. So the causative organism is Corynebacterium minutissimum, and it causes macular brown, well-defined lesions in a flexural distribution, very similar to fungal infection. It especially occurs in type 2 diabetics. The differential diagnosis, of course, is pityriasis versicolor, tinea cruris, or candidiasis. We use a wood light to shine on it, and you get a coral pink fluorescence. And it's treated, believe it or not, with topical azole antifungals or topical fusidic acid, which is an antibacterial, or we can give oral macrolide antibiotics as well. Fungal infections, the common ones are candidiasis, dermatophytosis, and other fungal infections, for example, mucormycosis. And this is here we have vulvovaginitis, but men can also get it. You can get balanitis, oral candidiasis, and what we call angular chelitis, where you actually have candida at the corners of the mouth. You can also get an erosive infection between the finger webs. We call that erosio interdigitalis lastomycetica. And or you can get chronic paronychia of the around the nail folds, especially in persons who put their hands in water quite a bit. Dermatophytoses are common, especially on the feet in your pedis, but you can also get it on the body in your corporis and involving the nails, onychomycosis as well. Now, there are other complications of diabetes. You can get diabetic rubeosis. It occurs in 3 to 5% of diabetics. It's a red face. It's not easily visible in dark skin. You have to really look for it. So it often goes unnoticed. It's caused by vasodilatation of the superficial vessels, and it may be associated with retinopathy. It improves with diabetic control. So on to what is this thing about itching and diabetes? We always are in contention with the physicians about this. Do you have itching or pruritus with skin disease? Is it without skin disease? Is it localized? Is it generalized? A few studies have been done. One showed that 49% of diabetics had itching. One done in Glasgow showed that pruritus vulvae occurred in 18.4% of diabetic women, and that 2.7% had generalized pruritus without cause. What are the things which can cause pruritus? Dry skin, xerosis, skin diseases, some of which we've gone through before, tenia corporis, candidiasis, lichen planus. Neuropathy itself can actually lead to itching, high blood sugar, and even some of the drugs that we use to treat. This constant itching can lead to what we call prurigo nodules. So if you see anybody with constant itching or who have prurigo nodules, as you see here, you need to, of course, investigate them for diabetes as part of your general workup. Diabetics also get xerosis or xeroderma, which is dry skin, by the way. It's a fancy name for dry skin. Up to 69% of diabetics get dry skin. And the proposed mechanism is that there's decreased hydration of the stratum corneum, decreased sebaceous gland activity, leading to decreased surface lipids, autonomic neuropathies, which affect the secretion of sweat and sebum, decreased blood flow. And studies have shown that these are actually easily preventative by just using emollients, including 10% urea, just to restore the barrier function of the skin and also to avoid harsh soaps. Nail dystrophy occurs as well. They get yellow nails, which are thickened, slow growing, with increased curvature. Other manifestations, periungual telangiectasia, which is just a fancy name for dilatation of the blood vessels around the nails. They can also get yellow skin, carotenemia. There can also be consequences of the microangiopathy, the macroangiopathy, and the neuropathy. From this, you can get ischemia of the vasa nervorum, the decreased skin elasticity, impaired endothelial vasomotor function, lower limb temperature, mottled coloring, loss of hair on the limbs, anhydrosis, calluses, poor wound healing, chronic ulcers, and eventually gangrene. And now, unfortunately, some of the drugs that we actually use to treat diabetes actually cause problems with the skin. So we have insulin, and you can have a local reaction. You can get pruritus, and induration at the site, dermal atrophy, hypertrophic lipodystrophy, granulomas where you've injected, injection site calcification. And some patients get more generalized responses like urticaria or anaphylaxis. Sulfonylureas are the ones that dermatologists worry about the most, I have to tell you. A lot of patients react, they get urticaria, exanthematous eruptions, pruritus, photodermatitis, lichenoid eruptions, exfoliative dermatitis, and the one we all dread, the Stevens-Johnson syndrome and toxic epidermal necrolysis, and they can also get alcohol-induced flushing. The bigonides can also cause pruritus, urticaria, and photosensitivity, and the thiazolidinediones can lead to edema. So in summary, physicians and healthcare workers should be able to recognize clinical manifestations of diabetes. And by the way, you don't need to remember all the fancy names. Just look at some, if you look at something and say, I'm sure this is associated with diabetes, you get on and do your investigation. You investigate patients early, especially when they have acanthosis nigricans. encourage control of diabetes mellitus, and educate your patients how to take care of their skin and avoid complications. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. East Ennis. Absolutely wonderful. I must say it's a very informative but frightening presentation. Ladies, gentlemen, we'll move now to the second presentation. We ask you to please stick with us. Don't abandon us this evening, I beg you. The next presentation, looking on the metabolic syndrome, will be delivered by Dr. Karen Phillips. She's a consultant physician and associate lecturer at the University of the West Indies in the Faculty of Medical Sciences, and also medical director for Revamp Comprehensive Rehabilitation Center. She completed a Master's of Science in Diabetes and Endocrinology from Queen Mary University of London, a Doctor of Medicine in Internal Medicine, University of the West Indies, and also a certificate in stroke rehabilitation. Her presentation, as mentioned before, will focus more on the metabolic syndrome. So can you please join me in giving Dr. Phillips a warm welcome.
Good afternoon. So for the next 20 minutes or so, I'll be just looking at the metabolic syndrome, which I think is a very important topic for us to discuss today, in that it is, I would want to think, arguably one of the most important drivers in terms of cardiovascular disease with all its problems in today's era. So initially I just want to give a brief background, look at, you know, the classification of this syndrome, mention some clinical features, how to assess these patients, and then look at treatment. All right. So there are a number of definitions of the metabolic syndrome. The one that I find most comprehensive and really represents what we're trying to state with this syndrome is that it's a clustering of metabolic abnormalities that has been associated with the risk of coronary heart disease, stroke, and cardiovascular mortality, which is greater than that of the individual components. And so what we want to stress here is that it's the collection of these components which carries this increased risk, and which is greater than the individual issues themselves. And the picture here just to represent that this may just be following how we are evolving as human beings from hunter-gatherers to the westernized persons we are today in the 21st century. So the alternative names for this syndrome, actually the components of the metabolic syndrome were well described even as early as the 1920s, but it wasn't until about the 1970s when a gentleman by the name of Haller was looking at some risk factors associated with atherosclerosis. He came up with a constellation of the components. However, he could not, and persons before him, they didn't really find a unifying theme. So it wasn't until 1988 when the gentleman Raven, well, he proposed that insulin resistance may actually be at the root in terms of pathophysiology for these cluster of conditions. And so it's also called Raven syndrome. Syndrome X is what he went on to call it as well. Also named the insulin resistance syndrome and the deadly quartet. So why are we talking about it? 1/4 of the world's adults today have metabolic syndrome. And as I said before, the incidence of the metabolic syndrome among Caribbean-born persons in the US Virgin Islands is comparable to that on mainland USA. So it's quite significant. Interestingly, Hispanic blacks have greater cardiovascular risk compared to other Caribbean-born persons living in the US Virgin Islands. And the persons with the metabolic syndrome are twice as likely to die from and 3 times as likely to have a heart attack and stroke than persons without this syndrome. And that is important. There's a 5-fold greater risk of developing type 2 diabetes. And we all know each year, millions of persons, 3.2 million people around the world, die from complications of diabetes. It's no joke. So what's happening locally in the Jamaican perspective, in a paper done by Ferguson et al, out of the ERU, the University of the West Indies. The prevalence was estimated locally at 21.1% using the International Diabetes Federation criteria, which I'll mention a little bit later on. They found in that paper also that the prevalence increased with age, and this is in keeping with other studies done internationally, and also a high income in this study was associated with increased odds of having the metabolic syndrome in males, but not in females. And so we're looking at the classification. Now, there are a number of groups, the WHO, the National Cholesterol Education Program, the European Group for the Study of Insulin Resistance. Varying groups have come together basically looking at the core components of the syndrome, but there was a lack of a unifying theme, and the persons found that it wasn't really easy to extrapolate from these varying classifications. So the International Diabetes Federation decided to come up with a more simple, pragmatic tool which could be utilized clinically as well as in research. And so they're recommending that it would be more practical, and I think this is now the established guideline for the diagnosis of the metabolic syndrome, where we look at one, persons who have obesity as evidenced or displayed as a waist circumference of more than or equal 90 inches in males and more than or equal 80 inches in females, plus two of any of those four that mentioned there, hypertriglyceridemia greater than or equal to 1.7 millimoles per liter, or patients being treated for that condition, patients who may have a low HDL cholesterol less than 1.03 millimoles per liter for males and less than 1.29 for females, or persons being treated for low HDL, persons who are hypertensive with a blood pressure greater than or equal to 130 over 85, or on medication for hypertension, and finally patients who are dysglycemic with a glucose of greater than or equal 5.6 millimoles per liter, or patients on specific medication or previously diagnosed with type 2 diabetes. And of course, I mentioned waist circumference, but it's important to know that there are ethnic variations. And so for different groups, for example, if you're Asian, the standard for your waist circumference will be less than, say, Caribbeans and Europeans. And so as displayed here, these are the reference ranges for waist circumference depending on your ethnicity. And of course, in certain areas where there are no established standards, for example, persons in sub-Saharan Africa, then the European data is used until more specific data becomes available. So we're back at this. Why are we talking about this today? Metabolic syndrome is linked to insulin resistance. It increases the risk of diabetes mellitus 5 times. It's associated with a fatty liver, and it's associated with several cancers, including possibly prostate cancer, and of course, as we've said before, 2 to 3 times increased risk of cardiovascular disease. So the risk factors are obvious. Overweight, obesity are central and key to this syndrome. And of course, a sedentary lifestyle, which will lead to obesity. Aging, we all know that as we grow older, we tend to increase our weight for varying reasons. Diabetes mellitus, coronary heart disease, multiple sclerosis, which may be not as obvious, but there's an association with autoimmune conditions and obesity in this for the metabolic syndrome, lipodystrophy through insulin resistance, medications, exposure to antipsychotic medications. Some of these medications can cause obesity and through other means can increase your risk of dysglycemia. Family history, of course, is important, and socioeconomic factors. When I go back a little bit, low vitamin D levels has also been associated with obesity and the insulin resistance syndrome, or metabolic syndrome, sorry. We've looked at the manifestations of acanthosis nigricans, which is a manifestation of insulin resistance, and the skin tags, as Dr. Easton has just mentioned. And just mention an overview of the associated conditions there. So cardiovascular disease, we spoke about that, type 2 diabetes, fatty liver, hyperuricemia, polycystic ovarian syndrome, obstructive sleep apnea, which is commonly associated with obesity, hypertension, and insulin resistance. And treatment of this condition does improve insulin sensitivity. Now, the pathogenesis is not well understood. As I said before, these are the core features. And I think basically what I would want you to take home from this is that outside of excessive dietary intake and outside of a lack of exercise, there are genetic factors and there are fetal programming factors which through insulin resistance, visceral obesity, hypothalamic pituitary axis dysfunction, and atherogenic dyslipidemia will lead to the metabolic syndrome. And specifically for type 2 diabetes, through insulin resistance, increasing lipolysis with increasing free fatty acids, again, ultimately can lead through impaired glucose uptake, insulin resistance, and toxic injury to pancreatic islets can lead to hypoglycemia and type 2 diabetes. Similarly, for coronary artery disease, through central obesity can lead to insulin resistance and hyperinsulinemia, which through glucose metabolism, dyslipidemia, and pro-inflammatory changes can also give rise to coronary artery disease. So how do we make the diagnosis? Of course, we've mentioned the criteria. As we said before, the presence of the waist circumference according to the targets discussed, plus two of the four, more than two of the other four manifestations. Plus, you know, you may ask patients about, in terms of looking at the association conditions, you can ask about symptoms referable to any of these, such as obstructive sleep apnea. So you may want to ask about daytime somnolence, etc., snoring at night, apneic spells at night, history of PCOS in premenopausal women, a family history of cardiovascular disease and diabetes. Well, clearly we would be measuring our waist circumference for the criteria and our blood pressure. In terms of laboratory investigations, clearly fasting lipid profile and glucose is important. Inflammatory markers such as a high sensitive CRP, fibrinogen, uric acid, and urinary microalbumin are important. Liver function tests, because we're interested in non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, sleep study, and of course our gonadotropins, as I mentioned, the role of PCOS. And how are we going to treat these patients? So basically the core and the standard established treatment for the metabolic syndrome really is quite simple and lies with lifestyle changes. It's a healthy lifestyle, therapeutic lifestyle, because as I would have mentioned, there's no uniform treatment for insulin resistance per se, affecting all of the different manifestations. So you really have to treat the individual conditions. So we start with diet, and basically we're talking about at least a 500 kilocalorie restriction per day, which really would equate to about losing about 1 pound of weight per week. The diets, of course, should be restricted in carbohydrate. Typically, this provides a rapid initial weight loss. Adherence to the diet is far more important than which diet is chosen. I see people spend a lot of time disputing, you know, which diet is better and which one is not. But really, just whatever you're choosing, just adherence is best. A high-quality diet, and I think everybody agrees that a high-quality diet would speak to enrichment in fruits, vegetables, whole grains, lean poultry, and fish. So definitely we want to encourage this to provide maximum overall health benefit. So generally, for dietary goals, you want to decrease your total calories, you want to increase your whole grains, you want to limit your total fat to about 20 to 35% of calories per day, and your saturated fats to less than 7% of calories per day. The recommended diets are Mediterranean and DASH type, but again, whatever diet you choose, adherence is what is most important, and you may consider consulting a nutritionist. As it relates to exercise, definitely we are advocating increased physical activity and behavior modification, which is particularly important because it's very easy to send a message about losing weight, but if patients don't change their behavior pattern, it will only be temporary. So, you know, we won't really achieve much. So we're recommending 60 to 90 minutes of daily activity, at least 30 minutes, and there should be gradually increases in physical activity rather than telling the patient to just start off really hardcore. You know, we really want to encourage adherence and we want to avoid injury. There are a number of cases of rhabdomyolysis presenting in hospitals nowadays because patients are going to the gym and first day they're lifting 90 pounds. You know, that's not what we're recommending at all. High-risk patients should undergo formal cardiovascular evaluation before initiating an exercise program. And physical activity can be formal exercise. It can be jogging, it can be swimming, it can be tennis, it can be routine activities, because a lot of persons can't afford a gym membership. A lot of persons can't afford to go to Bikram yoga. But you can garden, you can walk, you can clean your house. So even those things can really help to boost your calorie burning. As it relates to individual components, as I said before, outside of diet and exercise, we try to address the individual components, and key would be obesity. There are a number of FDA-approved obesity medications nowadays. Phentermine, which is an appetite suppressant, there's bupropion, there's liraglutide, there are a number of them. There's orlistat, as well as, more definitively, there's bariatric surgery. For patients who may be having a BMI of more than 40 kilograms per meter squared, or 35, more than 35 with comorbidities. As it relates to your lipids in terms of the triglycerides, if you remember that was a part of the classification, we really want our fasting triglyceride to be less than 1.7, and we need to lose about 10%, well, weight reduction of more than 10% is necessary to lower your fasting triglycerides. In terms of drugs, which can be useful for triglyceride lowering the fibrates, if you can get them, gemfibrozil or fenofibrate, these are the drugs of choice, and they can lower your triglycerides by 35 to 50%. There are other drugs such as statins, nicotinic acid, and high doses of omega-3, which may be useful. For HDL cholesterol, weight reduction is the most important strategy. Nicotinic acid is the only currently available drug with predictable HDL cholesterol lowering properties. Statins, fibrates, and bile acid secretions may also be useful. In terms of low density lipoprotein cholesterol, for those patients, we really want to reduce this to about less than 2.5 millimoles per liter with the statins primarily. Blood pressure, again, we know about the relationship with blood pressure, and for these particular patients, the ACEs and ARBs are the best choice, the best first choice, and of course, diet, sodium-restricted diet, less than 1.5 grams for the day, and low-fat dairy products should be advocated. In terms of insulin resistance itself, there are two medications, the thiazolidinediones and the biguanides, which specifically improve insulin sensitivity. Both of them will suppress hepatic glucose output, and the thiazolidinediones will improve insulin-mediated glucose uptake in muscles and adipose tissue. And both have been useful in non-alcoholic fatty liver PCOS. As it relates to glycemic control, aggressive glycemic control is most important, even though we know that to date studies still have not conclusively shown significant benefit in macrovascular complications just with glycemic lowering alone, but it is important and we should not forget it. Lifestyle intervention has also been shown to be important to reduce the incidence of type 2 diabetes and metformin. The prothrombotic and pro-inflammatory states, which can be addressed by looking at using aspirin, for example, low-dose aspirin in patients who have a high cardiovascular risk or with over type 2 diabetes. And to note that the metabolic syndrome is frequently accompanied by a pro-inflammatory state, which is characterized by high CRP levels, but there's no specific treatment available for this. So in terms of reviewing of the goals that we want to leave with you today, these patients, definitely we are advocating a decrease in caloric intake, change the type of caloric intake, decrease the carbs, increase activity, lower BP, increase the HDL cholesterol, lower your elevated triglycerides, and control hyperglycemia. Our key points being that management should be aggressive. All patients should undergo a full cardiovascular risk assessment. Primary management is a healthy lifestyle. When lifestyle change is not enough, drug therapy may be required. And the individual components of the syndrome must be treated in order to reduce the overall impact on cardiovascular disease and diabetes risk. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Phillips. Ladies and gentlemen, we now have the final presentation for today, and to be delivered by Dr. Arthur East Innes again. She'll be looking at the metabolic syndrome and the skin, and we promise to get you out of here by 10 past 5, so please bear with us.
Give her a warm welcome.
So she has cut my talking half, because the first slide is metabolic syndrome, what is it? So I don't need to go through that again. But just to say it's the name for a group of risk factors that occur together and increase the risk for coronary artery disease, cerebrovascular disease or stroke, or type 2 diabetes. And the two most important risk factors for metabolic syndrome are central obesity and insulin resistance. So we won't go through that. Now, some of the skin diseases that are associated with metabolic syndrome are long known. You've been hearing them over and over, but I have a few surprises at the end just to keep you awake for the end. So we'll start with our old favorite, acanthosis nigricans. You must know everything about it by now. It was first documented in 1889, and in 1909, it was found to be associated with internal malignancy. But by 1976, they were noticing that it was also associated with insulin resistance. And by the year 2000, the American Diabetes Association established it as a formal risk factor for the development of diabetes in children. And you've been seeing these slides. It occurs in the neck, intertriginous areas. You get this hyperpigmented velvety area. In children, most times you see it at the posterior neck. It may be associated with skin tags or acrocordons, as we call them, as well. And it may affect the mucous membranes, the areola of the nipple, may even affect the conjunctival membrane of the eyes, and you can also have nail changes. But when you see things like that, you have to think, is this really malignant? This may be a little beyond the insulin resistant. Associated acanthosis nigricans. If patients have involvement of the esophagus or they have what we call tripe palms, if you see that pebbly look like tripe, then think that they may actually have a malignancy rather than a diabetic problem. Now, it is thought that acanthosis nigricans occurs by factors which stimulate epidermal keratinocyte and dermal fibroblast proliferation. In the benign forms, we think that this is either insulin itself or an insulin-like growth factor. And at high concentrations, insulin itself may act on insulin growth factor 1 receptors. In addition, the free IGF-1 levels may be elevated in obese patients with hyperinsulinemia. There are other proposed mediators as well, especially in those who have malignancies. Now, obesity is closely associated with acanthosis nigricans. More than half the adults who weigh greater than 200% of their ideal body weight have lesions consistent with acanthosis nigricans. International studies all over the world agree with this, that is associated with obesity and insulin resistance. The mortality and morbidity, the mortality is only associated with the underlying insulin resistance, and of course, if they have a malignancy. There are actually 9 types of acanthosis nigricans, but I'll just go through 5, which I think you need to know about. The obesity-associated acanthosis nigricans, which we've just more or less gone through. Then you have syndromic acanthosis nigricans, and there are 2 main syndromes that I would like you to remember. We have type A and type B syndromes. Type A, they have hyperandrogenemia, insulin resistance, acanthosis nigricans syndrome, which we call Hair-An syndrome. And this is usually found in young black women. It's associated with polycystic ovaries, so it's part of the whole polycystic ovarian syndrome. And they may have signs of virilization as well, including hirsutism and clitoral hypertrophy. And they may have high plasma testosterone levels. And the type B occurs in women who have uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, ovarian hyperandrogenism, and an autoimmune disease such as systemic lupus erythematosus, scleroderma, Sjogren's, or Hashimoto thyroiditis. And they usually have circulating antibodies to the insulin receptor. Drug-induced acanthosis nigricans, and this occurs commonly in drugs which actually increase your insulin resistance, So corticosteroids, even giving insulin itself can produce acanthosis nigricans, and things like oral contraceptives, thank God, rarely you can also get that as well. If you discontinue the drug, usually the lesions will regress. And I had to put in malignant acanthosis nigricans because I always want you to remember that, does this person really have malignancy on board? So you should think about investigating them for it. And then you have mixed type. You have people who have, say, obesity type acanthosis nigricans, and on top of that, they get a malignancy-associated acanthosis nigricans. So the takeaway message for this is that patients who come with acanthosis nigricans should get a basic workup for underlying malignancy and also a screen for diabetes as well. And the treatment is really the treatment of the underlying cause, whether it's the obesity or if there's a malignancy, it is dealt with appropriately. We can do treatment to improve the appearance, but it's not long-standing treatment. It will just come back as soon as we stop. Acrocordons, which we mentioned before, these are called fibroepithelial polyps, skin tags. They are associated with acanthosis nigricans, but they can also occur by themselves, and they're independently associated with insulin resistance and increased risk for myocardial infarction. Now, psoriasis. Now, you've heard about psoriasis before, so I can go really quickly through this. We know it's a common inflammatory skin disease which causes thick, inflamed, scaly patches on the skin. It affects between 2% and 4% of adults. And it has been associated with an increased risk of myocardial infarction, strokes, and cardiovascular mortality. It's associated with the metabolic syndrome and its components, such as obesity, diabetes mellitus, and hypertension. And various studies have been done, including one done by Gelfand et al., who showed that psoriasis may confer an independent risk of MI, and that the risk was greatest in young patients with severe psoriasis. Other studies have been done. The Boston Collaborative Drug Surveillance Program study, we show that the risk factors for cardiovascular diseases as well as myocardial infarction and other vascular diseases occur with high incidence in patients with psoriasis than in the general population. And at the time, in 2008, they said further studies needed to be done. Well, several studies have been done since then. There's one that's just been published, which has put a little spanner in the works, and basically, it's by Egbert et al., which suggests that there's not an increased risk of MI in patients with mild psoriasis. But when you limit the study to first-time myocardial infarction, the risk was increased only in patients with severe psoriasis aged less than 50 years. And no association was found between psoriatic arthritis and myocardial infarction. This is actually, it's not yet in print, it's online, it's just the abstract. So we eagerly await the methods to see exactly the details of how this study was done. There's increased risk for diabetes mellitus and cardiovascular disease. Again, various studies which have confirmed this. And there's thought to be a component related to the inflammatory process. So it's thought that the chronic inflammatory changes, in particular the secretion of pro-inflammatory cytokines, contribute to this increase. And it's interesting to note that if you use TNF inhibitors, tumor necrosis factor inhibitors, which are seriously immunosuppressive, that you also get a lower risk of myocardial infarction. I'm going to skip some of these because You've gone through them before, but the take-home message is that patients with psoriasis should be screened for the metabolic syndrome. They should be advised of the association and appropriate lifestyle changes, and they should be followed up for the emergence of these risk factors. Acne, diet, and insulin resistance. Acne vulgaris, we all know, is the most common skin condition. It's a multifactorial disorder of the pilosebaceous unit. And the epidemiological data shows that it occurs in 85% of persons between the ages of 15 and 24 in the United States. And eventually, it will affect 60 to 70% of Americans at some point in their lives. I'll just go on to some of the connections. Now, initially, we used to say that it's not associated with diet until several persons went to indigenous populations which are not exposed to the Western diet. So the Eskimos or Inuits in Alaska and Canada, groups in Papua New Guinea and other remote areas like that, even some African tribes who do not eat westernized diet, and they found that they had no acne, they had no features of the metabolic syndrome. And so we started to think, well, maybe we should start to look at the diet again. And so several dietary studies have been done with acne. As you can see here, acne has now been shown to be associated with dairy products, milk, yogurt, any of these things. The only dairy product that is not associated with is dairy products that have been cooked or denatured, like the cheese that you use on pizza, but you don't really want to encourage people to eat pizza. And it's thought that you have insulin-like growth factors within the milk and other steroids like androgen type steroids as well, which promotes acne. Now we've heard yesterday, we heard that skimmed milk is worse than full fat milk, because they think it's because it has a higher glycemic index. But we have two very contradictory studies here. This first study by La Rosa et al. Suggested that it was skim milk that was the problem, because it has all the sugar in there and no fat to slow down the entry of the sugar into the body. And so that was what caused acne. But then a Norwegian study showed the opposite. It actually showed that full fat milk was associated with acne and skim milk was okay. So the bottom line is there's something in milk which is causing the problem. They've also shown that high glycemic index foods, so sweet foods basically, contribute to acne vulgaris. And there's a growing body of studies. Several studies were done with regard to this. Also, insulin resistance is associated, and several studies have been done to confirm it. They had to particularly do one with men, because we know that it's associated with women, especially in things like the polycystic ovarian disease that is associated. So we had to do a special study for men, and the same thing was found, that it's also associated with insulin resistance in men. So this is the end part that you hadn't thought about. So what about male pattern baldness, thoracic hairiness, and earlobe crease? I've put them together because a lot of studies have actually put them together. So in these studies, they found that baldness, short stature, thoracic hairiness, and diagonal earlobe crease are found in some patients with atherosclerosis. And they have been associated with an increased incidence of coronary heart disease. The mechanism is unclear, and genetic abnormalities may be responsible. But hold on a minute, we're going to show you some more studies. It might not be true. So the initial study was in 1979, and that started with a diagonal earlobe crease. And it was found that it was a cutaneous manifestation of coronary artery disease. And you ask, what is a diagonal earlobe crease? This is a normal ear on your left, and this is a diagonal earlobe crease on your right. And this is what it looks like. And ladies, I know you will be checking later on in the bathroom. Please remove your earrings before you check, because this is where your earring would probably be, right in the middle. So you have to remove them first. This was actually confirmed in 1983 with a study of 1,000 patients, that there was a high degree of correlation between the earlobe crease and coronary artery disease using both clinical and angiographic criteria for diagnosis of CAD. More recent studies also examine the association of baldness, thoracic hairiness, hair graying, and diagonal earlobe crease with the risk of myocardial infarction. And they concluded that all of these were associated with this. This is what we call male pattern baldness, that loss of hair at the frontal scalp and in the vertex. Again, there was a study done in 2000 which suggested that baldness was associated with coronary atherosclerosis. But in 2008, along came someone else who did a study, Shahar et al., and they actually found that there was no difference in the carotid intimal medial thickness between groups of men with various types of male pattern baldness and their baldness-free counterparts. There was no difference. So men with male pattern baldness, you can now relax. It is not a surrogate measure of a risk factor for MI or asymptomatic atherosclerosis. What about premature hair graying? This study done in 2012 by Kokoman et al. Showed that the degree of gray-white hairs is related to coronary artery disease, and hair graying is a risk factor for coronary artery disease independent of age and other traditional risk factors. This is how it works. You have to go across the age group. So if you compare yourself to your own peers, so if you're 50 years old and you have a full head of gray hair, you compare it to another 50-year-old who has no graying, or say less than 5 to 10% graying. And epidemiologically, you are likely to have a greater risk for coronary artery disease than they do. There were two further studies done in 2013 and 2015 which confirmed that premature graying is an independent risk factor for coronary artery disease, even in persons who smoke. And I had to plug in this last one. This is a study we did at the UHWI, submitted for publication but not yet published. And we did a study on acne keloidalis nuchae, which is the papular eruption on the nape of the neck or on the occipital scalp, occurs mainly in men but can occur in women. And we found that those that had the more severe forms, meaning it extended from the nape of the neck and went all over the scalp, were 14 times more likely to have one or more component of the metabolic syndrome when compared to the persons who had much more limited disease. So acanthosis nigricans, skin tags, psoriasis, acne, diagonal earlobe crease, early graying, and thoracic hairs can all be indicators of a present or impending metabolic syndrome. Just to point out that I didn't see any further studies on this thoracic hair, so I can't comment. And of course, there need to be further studies of the role of metabolic syndrome in acne keloidalis nuchae. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Eastins. You shouldn't scare our men so much, you know. I saw Dr. Bailey starting to sweat for a while. We want to thank our presenters for those three lovely presentations. Can we please give them a round of applause? I want to thank you, ladies, for taking the time out to share your knowledge, your experiences, as well as the outcome of your research. And we also ask Dr. Eastins to extend our regards to Dr. Sweet for putting our presentation together. We have time for just about two questions, but just before we take those questions, I want to just take a little time out to recognize our main sponsors. The Petroleum Corporation of Jamaica is one of the gold sponsors to this conference, as well as PetroJam Jamaica Limited, a silver sponsor, as well as our title sponsors, UII, UTEC, NCU, Diabetes Association, and the Heart Trust NTA. We also want to encourage all of our participants to please visit our exhibitors' booths, see what products and services they have to offer, and as you get a chance, review as well as discuss the output of the presentations and the posters at the back with our authors. Ladies and gentlemen, we take these two quick questions and then we'll close out for the day. And Dr. Bale, I hope it's nothing related to baldness.
I'm terribly worried, Cliff. I'm not sure I should have attended this session. You see, a classmate of mine died recently. He was short. He was fat. His chest was really hairy. And I want to ask you a question, Dr. East. Is shortness an independent risk factor for CAD? I mean, I'm really worried here. It seems as if everything worries me at this conference.
Actually, it only appeared in one study, I've not seen it since then. And since they were all more or less lumped together, I can't really say it's an independent risk factor.
You're very kind. The next issue has to do with baldness, because is it early baldness or late baldness? It's important for us.
You see, I've got to be really worried.
No, it doesn't matter whether it's early or late. In the end, there's no association. The final study said there was no association. So there is no association. But initially, they thought that it was genetically associated with the gene that gives you male pattern baldness. But all the recent studies have negated all of that. So you don't have to worry about that either.
Lovely. So, Dr. Bill, I think you can rest easier tonight. Do we have any other question? Yes.
Karen, that was a very clear and excellent presentation. I think if there's a physician next to Dr. Bailey, please check his earlobe. And also if there's any hair on his chest. My question is, if I have two patients coming to my office, both age 60, one has an abdominal girth of 42 inches, but his blood pressure, his HDL, his blood sugar is perfectly normal, and another chap who comes in, age 60, with a waist circumference of 26 inches, but he has the other criteria. Neither one has the metabolic syndrome. Which one are you worried about and why?
Okay, that sounds like an exam question.
No, it's not an exam question. I think the point I'm trying to make is that the metabolic syndrome is but a constellation of risk factors.
Of risk factors, right.
And when you see somebody with a waist of 42, I don't care what their HDL is.
Exactly.
There's nothing I can do about it. It really doesn't matter what their blood pressure is, because treating their weight will send on that systolic blood pressure. So I think the metabolic syndrome is interesting for publishing papers and getting PhDs. But if you see someone with a waist circumference of 40 inches, aggressively treat that person regardless of the other. They've got insulin resistance,
yes,
trust me.
Yes.
And I think that is why that's a key component. And it really is looking at risk factors. What I really wanted to find out is, do you think in your reading, is it genetic? People with metabolic syndrome, are there other family members with it? In other words, do you have a choice or are you destined to develop metabolic syndrome genetically?
Definitely. I mean, family history is a risk factor. And there are genetic markers which have been associated with the metabolic syndrome as well. So I think both. I think a lot of it is really not clear. And even the classification criteria is really, as you said, mainly for research purposes and just to a more practical approach to it, to organize the whole understanding of the clustering of risk factors. But as you do say, abdominal obesity clearly I mean, just in and of itself is significant as it relates to insulin resistance. And the pathogenesis is again not clear, but based on what I've been reading, as we said, genetic factors play a role, family history playing a role, aging plays a role, there are a number of things. But I think there's a lot that needs to be worked out in terms of the metabolic syndrome. But I think the take home point is really that the association with significant cardiovascular risk and, you know, the implications of that in our current society.
Thank you very much. Can we ask you to follow up with both Drs. Phillips as well as East Innes later on for other questions?